Back, I would say back in the 40s and the 50s, when a lot of African Americans were migrating to the West from the South for the jobs and industrialism and things like that, there were certain areas where African Americans or blacks were living, and they were not allowed to cross certain boundaries and go certain areas. So a lot of times when they would travel, they would be discriminated against or they would be persecuted because of their race. And so what ended up happening is they began to group together. And it really wasn't like gangs. It was like called the Gladiators, the Slawsons, and so on. And they basically got together to protect themselves as they went to school, or went out to party, or have a nice time and things like that. They began to form these groups. But then what happened is when you had the white, what you call the white flight, a lot of whites began to move out of the community. And so then you had all the blacks, and so you had Slawson, Gladiators, so then they begin to rival with each other, you know, in parks and then you hang out and things like that. But it's basically just fighting, you know. Every now and then somebody might get stabbed or get shot, but if somebody got shot, stabbed, or killed, it'd be the news, it'd be, you know, a real big thing. Then when you got into the 60s, you had the Black Panther movement, and most blacks kind of rallied behind that. It was about community and the black movement and so on. But after the Black Panther movement dissipated, was done away with, there was no leadership there. There was like a vacuum. And so you had, up in LA, you had Raymond Washington. I know a lot of people might have heard of him. They formed a group, and it basically, when they first formed that group, it was kind of, they were trying to mimic the Black Panther in a sense to protect the community and do things like that, but they really didn't have any strong leadership there. And so out of that, they began to gangbang against each other, fight each other, you know, west side, east side, and so on. And then in the media, they beat up a guy one time, and in the media, either because they called themselves the Cribs or because they wore canes that nobody really know. But that's how they formed the word Cribs. In the media, they used the word Crib, so they began to use that term. And at the beginning, Cribs got a lot of recognition for things that they really didn't do. Every time there was a violent crime or something that happened in the community, they said Cribs did it. And so they took that and they ran with it. And supposedly there was a fight over a leather jacket, and there was a little rivalry there. And so what ended up happening out of that is that's how the Bloods. Bloods actually came out of the Cribs. And then you had the Bloods and you had the Cribs being a rival with each other. They don't know who drew first blood as far as the shooting and killing, but somewhere along the line that did happen. And because there were more Crips than Bloods, the Bloods were basically more violent and using guns and things like that to protect themselves. And what ended up happening is a gentleman by the name of Sitting Bull, we call him Robert Green. He lived in San Diego over in District 8 off of 28th and Clay Street, 29th and Clay Street. And I lived right across the street from him. He used to travel back and forth to LA to San Diego. And there was a, when I was young, about 12 years old, there was a group called, they called themselves West Coast LTD, which was West Coast Limited. They would wear jackets, and they were really organized. They used to have parties at Memorial Park. They even had a contract with the city, and they kept things kind of in order. But from that, being West Coast LTD, Sidney Bull or Robert, he was a part of that group. And because he traveled back and forth to LA, they became what they call West Coast Wrecking Crew. And that's kind of when I started getting involved in it. They called themselves West Coast Wrecking Crew. And it's more of a violent type, but just fighting and things like that. And then from there, Robert suggested that we become Crips over there in West Coast. So actually, the first Crip gang in San Diego was West Coast Crips, which was the gang that I was a part of. And then, you know, from that, that's why San Diego is like, they call it a blood city, because of us. We were probably one of the largest gangs during that time, and we were committing a lot of the violent acts, and so we was at war with everybody, and so most of the other African-American gangs ended up becoming Bloods except neighborhood Cribs, and then later on, yeah, he said what he said, he's a mile later on, and so on. So that's kind of like a little history of it when you deal with African-American gangs.
It also, like, Pastor Bowser was saying, with the Hispanics as well, as, you know, they would collaborate together to kind of support one another. But once, like, drugs started coming in, and then they were limited as far as their opportunities, instead of collaborating with each other, they, and forming, like, a political group, they started, like, you know, divisions began amongst the group because of all the competition of money and you know, just territory, and so they started turning on themselves. So that's really, really, it's kind of like, you know, Fred Finn Chew Center, you know, you go for a contract, wraparound contract, and you got like four competitors, you know, going for the same, but you know, everyone's their own. But it's really at the bottom of the line, at the end of the day, it's really about needs. It really comes, you know, it's really about needs. And so when you look at a gang member now, and you just see kind of like the facade of the gang, the way it formed, it really formed out of needs, belonging, culture, community, collaboration. And then, of course, with everything else coming in, it kind of started tweaking into something else.
And I would just say also, recent LA, which when you deal with the dress code and things like that, outside of the colors, among African Americans, you know, the way they dress with the Pemptons and Cactus and things like that, they're kind of the gang culture dress style. They actually adopted that for the Mexican American gangs that was in LA during the time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Helpful in jumping in. So you guys want to go ahead and kind of share who you are, you know, maybe, you know, since you guys all have gang experience, you know, maybe the gang as well as, you know, what you're doing now.
I'm Cornelius Bowser, and I'm a pastor of a Charity Apostolic Church well in the East County area. I'm a former West Coast Christian, as you mentioned, a former X or whatever term you want to use. But I got involved in gangs back in the early 70s, probably like 74, somewhere around there. And I got out in 84. And I got out in gangs when I got saved, got in church, and that's what turned me around from gangs. What motivated me or moved me from it was, you know, God. What my testimony is that even when God was dealing with me and trying to wake me up and get me out of the game, I didn't want to leave because I was so attached to my homeboys. That was my life and my family, and I didn't want to give it up. But then the Lord opened my eyes to see. I saw one of my homeboys get killed, and come to find out it was one of my homeboys that killed one of my homeboys. And so that was, you know, even though that's a trend that's really happening today, I'll give an example. Homicide gang unit probably have about four homicides from last year. But I have, the stats that I've been keeping, there's about 15 homicides. But most of those homicides from last year are intra-gang related, where a gang member killed a gang member. And so you have, you know, that's a common thing that's happening today. And so back then it wasn't that common as it is today. And because I was so sold out to the gang, when I saw that, that's what opened up my eyes to leave the gang. And so, you know, I've been in church, I've been pastoring since 1995. That's for about 18 years. Been involved with dealing with the gang since I've been saved, as far as trying to help folks get out. About 4 years ago, I would say I got more involved in the community, in the sense of trying to work very community with Pastor Sandoval and others in the community to try to help those who are in gangs to get out. And so through our church, we have a program called Shafat Outreach. You can go to charityapostolic.org and just click Shafat Outreach. We have resources and information there about gangs and police also. And so that's some little basic information about myself.
Good morning. First and foremost, my nickname, they call me Big Blinks. My little name is Chris P. E. I was born and raised in Eastside, San Diego, which nowadays they call it City Heights. You know, I was born and raised with a good, loving, caring family. You know, the youngest out of four children, but also the direction of four children. You know, at the age of 12, I started out, you know, making my own decisions, my own choices, getting more involved in the street culture, in the gang culture, and in the prison culture. And I landed up doing a good portion of my life behind, you know, prison walls, basically. You know, level four, supermax institutions, you know, taking it to the next level, you know, to the highest level, peak, you can say, as a gang